And our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 23. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors. Who is the King of Glory? Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors. Our first hymn is number 410. If you want the music, it's in the dark blue hymn books, and it's Joyful, Joyful, We Adore You. Let's stand and sing together. Restore our relationships, restore our deep love for for you and for one another. Thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus, who came to us not in our strength and triumph, but in our weakness and need, who gave his life for us and died so that we might be free, and who rose and is with us now. So trusting in your presence, Jesus, trusting in your mercy, we offer this time to you, offer ourselves to you, trusting in your grace. All this we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. And now together we share the prayer that he taught, saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Hear the good news. In Christ, you are forgiven, made whole, and free. Receive this gift and know God's peace. Amen. In the gift of God's forgiveness, we are also given the gift of one another, the gift of being part of God's family. As a sign of this, please turn to the people around you and share the words, The peace of Christ be with you. Our next hymn is number 314, God is Love, Come Heaven Adore. Let's stand and sing it.
Thank you.
Over the last number of weeks, we've been reading through the book of 1 Samuel. Last week, we met a young boy named David, who was the only brother not brought when Samuel came to find one of Jesse's sons who would be king. And now we join in probably the most famous story in this book of the Bible. It's a time of war and strife in what's now the Middle East. And let's listen for God speaking to us today through this word. And in order to do that, let's ask for help. Holy Spirit, we ask that you will move in us, that these words that we read may speak to us in our lives now. Holy Spirit, I ask for your help to preach your word faithfully with love and truth. In Jesus' name, amen. The Philistines now mustered their army for battle and camped between Socah and Judah and Azekah in Ephes Damim. Saul countered by gathering his Israelite troops near the valley of Elah. So the Philistines and Israelites faced each other on opposite hills, with the valley between them. Then Goliath, a Philistine champion from Gath, came out of the Philistine ranks to face the forces of Israel. He was over 9 feet tall. He wore a bronze helmet, and his bronze coat of mail weighed 125 pounds. He also wore bronze leg armor and carried a bronze javelin on his shoulder. The shaft of his spear was as heavy and thick as a weaver's beam, tipped with an iron spearhead that weighed 15 pounds. His armor bearer walked ahead of him, carrying a shield. Goliath stood and shouted a taunt across to the Israelites. "Why are you all coming out to fight?" he called. "I'm the Philistine champion, but you are only the servants of Saul. Choose one man to come down here and fight me. If he kills me, then we'll be your slaves. But if I kill him, you'll be our slaves. I defy the armies of Israel today. Send me a man who will fight me." When Saul and the Israelites heard this, they were terrified and deeply shaken. As soon as the Israelite army saw him, they began to run away in fright. "Have you seen the giant?" the men asked. "He comes out each day to defy Israel. The king has offered a huge reward to anyone who kills him. He will give that man one of his daughters for a wife, and the man's entire family will be exempted from paying taxes." Oh, sorry. I should have mentioned, I skipped a bunch of verses because this is a really long story. David's dad has sent him with food for his older brothers who are in the army, and David has just heard Goliath taunt. All right, let's keep going. David asked the soldiers standing nearby, "What will a man get for killing this Philistine and ending his defiance of Israel? Who is this pagan Philistine, anyway, that he is allowed to defy the armies of the living God?" And these men gave David the same reply. They said, "Yes, that is the reward for killing him." But when David's oldest brother, Eliab, heard David talking to the men, he was angry. "What are you doing around here anyway?" he demanded. "What about those few sheep you're supposed to be taking care of? I know about your pride and deceit. You just want to see the battle." "What have I done now?" David replied. "I was only asking a question." He walked over to some others and asked them the same thing, and received the same answer. Then David's question was reported to King Saul, and the king sent for him. "Don't worry about this Philistine," David told Saul. "I'll go fight him." "Don't be ridiculous," Saul replied. "There's no way you could fight this Philistine and possibly win. You're only a boy, and he's been a man of war since his youth." But David persisted. "I've been taking care of my father's sheep and goats," he said. "When a lion or a bear comes to steal a lamb from the flock, I go after it with a club and rescue the lamb from its mouth. If the animal turns on me, I catch it by the jaw and club it to death. I've done this to both lions and bears, and I'll do it to this pagan Philistine too, for he has defied the armies of the living God." The Lord who rescued me from the claws of the lion and the bear will rescue me from this Philistine. Saul finally consented. All right, go ahead, he said, and may the Lord be with you. Then Saul gave David his own armor, a bronze helmet and a coat of mail. David put it on, strapped the sword over it, and took a step or two to see what it was like, for he'd never worn such things before. I can't go in these, he protested to Saul. I'm not used to them. So David took them off again. He picked up 5 smooth stones from a stream and put them into his shepherd's bag. Then, armed only with his shepherd's staff and a sling, he started across the valley to fight the Philistine. Goliath walked out toward David with his shield bearer ahead of him, sneering in contempt at this ruddy-faced boy. Am I a dog, he roared at David, that you come at me with a stick? And he cursed David by the names of his gods. Come over here, I'll give your flesh to the birds and wild animals, Goliath yelled. David replied to the Philistine, you come to me with sword, spear, and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of Heaven's armies, the God of the armies of Israel, who you have defied. Today the Lord will conquer you, and I will kill you and cut off your head, and then I will give the dead bodies of your men to the birds and wild animals, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. And everyone assembled here will know that the Lord rescues his people, but not with sword and spear. This is the Lord's battle, and he will give you to us. As Goliath moved closer to attack David quickly ran out to meet him. Reaching into his shepherd's bag and taking out a stone, he hurled it with his sling and hit the Philistine in the forehead. The stone sank in, and Goliath stumbled and fell face down on the ground. So David triumphed over the Philistine with only a sling and a stone, for he had no sword. Then David ran over and pulled Goliath's sword from his sheath. David used it to kill him and cut off his head. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Finish this common phrase. Sometimes you have to fight fire with. So I have an announcement from the Leading with Care Health and Safety Committee. For the good of our church's safety, we are now going to replace all the fire extinguishers with matches. It's a funny phrase, isn't it? Sometimes you have to fight fire with fire. It's not completely false, right? Like, if there's a big forest fire coming that's sweeping towards an area you want to protect, sometimes you do a smaller burn to clear out brush. But usually, what do you fight fire with? Water. Maybe sand, maybe carbon dioxide. Usually, what's the last thing you want to fight fire with? Fire. And yet, we do, it's a phrase, sometimes you have to fight fire with fire, because boy do we ever want to, right? Have to stand up to a bully is common wisdom. That's not false, necessarily. But you know how I've heard that phrase used, you have to stand up to a bully, is if someone's being aggressive with you, what do you do? You get aggressive with them, right? If someone is rude to you, what do? You give them back what they're giving you, right? Sometimes you have to fight fire with fire, you have to fight aggression with aggression. I'll be polite if you're polite to me, and if you're rude, I'll be rude back to you. And you know what they tend to get? An inferno. Right? Situations just escalate and escalate and escalate. I wish that the story of an Israelite and Philistine army camped on opposite hills, shouting insults and threats of violence at each other, sounded like it was ancient history. And I wish it sounded like something that's only foreign and doesn't happen in our own city streets and alleyways and homes today. How do you fight fire? How do you stand up to a bully? I'll go big. What do you do about evil? What do you do about hate? What do you do about aggression? How do you fight? The David and Goliath story is up there among the most familiar stories from the entire Bible. I haven't done a study, it's probably not number one, but I'm guessing it's right up there. And people use it as a shorthand for underdog stories all the time. Now, while this football team is 17-0 going into this game, and they're up against the scrappy underdogs, it's a real David and Goliath story. It's action packed, right? And it's got the big turnaround, you know, the big giant. And in some ways, the use of the word giant isn't helpful, right? Because it makes it sound like it's in the same category as Jack and the Beanstalk. And what's Jack and the Beanstalk? A fairy tale. We love fairy tales. They have simple morals, right? David and Goliath, the underdog versus the giant. You know, you win by your cunning and resolve. And because it's such a familiar story, and because it's such an easy story with a lovely villain and a lovely hero, we can miss the hope and the challenge it gives to us today. So let's look at some of these details. Because I think they matter to us when we're faced with fire, when we're faced with evil, when we're faced with the challenges of life and ask, how are you going to react? First, Goliath's height is mentioned twice in a very offhand way. It's part of why he's scared. One set of ancient texts says he's about 9.5 feet tall. The other one says he's about 6'9". 9.5 feet tall is more unusual, right? That very few humans get to 9 feet tall. But he's not a giant, he's a person. Right? The word giant makes us think of fantasy stories, makes us think of fairy tales. Goliath is a big dude. Have you ever played in a sports match where you're lined up with someone way, way bigger than you? Right? It's a scary thing. The other use of his height is when the Israelite army says, run away from the giant. Right? He's got that mystique. But he's not named giant most. He's named champion. The literal word is funny in Hebrew. It's one who stands between. The guy who goes out in front of the army and stands there on his own, facing a horde of enemies. Goliath actually looks like a superhero in the stories that we love to tell so much. You know those Marvel movies that, I mean, they're still rolling them out. I haven't seen one in a while, but for a long time, you couldn't turn on the TV without seeing an ad for something new with Iron Man in it. Goliath is the hero of the story. If what you care about is conventional power, what's given way more detail than his height is his gear. Right? The Bible spends three verses verses describing the weight of his armor and his, you know, the size of the head of his spear and his multiple sets of weaponry used for different things. And he's got, you know, a guy moving out in front of him with his shield. You know that point, it's a classic trope in an action movie where the hero gears up. Iron Man is a good example where, you know, that's a, you know, cool sound. Or, you know, the sound of a sword, like shing, because sharpness is a noise in movies. Right? Or the shh, right? The gun over the shoulder, and then the heroes stride out all ready for battle. And what does your heart do when the heroes are gearing up?
Yeah.
Goliath gets the action movie intro in the book of 1 Samuel because he's a champion. And it sounds strange to us that in his deal, where he marches out and says, instead of having a battle, let's do a one-on-one. And whoever wins the one-on-one wins the war. Right? And the end result of a war is horrifying. Right? You will be our slaves or we'll be your slaves. The human cost of this is awful, as the human cost of war still is. Right? The object of this is to own your enemies. But Goliath, going out as a champion, is a way of reducing the suffering for everyone. He's the champion, he's the hero, right? A battle is a horrible thing, whether you win or lose. And two armies camped on hills, whoever goes down into the valley first will lose, or will at least lose more people. So here's an alternative. Instead of a battle between armies, you get the one hero who stands between. Goliath is a story of power. Power used well by an expert in it. And I'd just like us to think how we, in our culture, in the stories we tell and the stories we live, we're on Goliath's side more often than not. Goliath is who we want to look up to. A man of war since his youth. He's been training for this his whole life. Goliath's not identified as a giant. He's identified as a hero. A hero of battle. Now, the background of this story that we read a number of weeks ago is that Israel wanted a king. And the exact phrase is, a king so we can be like the other people around us. We can be like other nations. A king who will lead us in battle. And the Lord tells Samuel, they haven't rejected you as a leader, they've rejected me as their king. When they do this. And they did pick a king. They picked Saul, who was tall and strong and handsome, a hero who can face the enemy heroes. And we have a gearing up scene for Saul, right? Saul's armor is described in detail. Ka-ching, ka-ching. But this story is about something else than that kind of power. We have a setup for an amazing confrontation of, in this corner, fire, and in this corner, better fire. And that's not what happens. Because a kid shows up. And the climax of the story is going to be his line. All this is going to show that the Lord rescues his people, but not with sword and spear. Not by making someone better at conventional power, but by doing things differently. The introduction of David to his army is people describing the reward that people will, that whoever defeats Goliath will get. They'll get to marry the princess. Again, doesn't that sound like an action movie or, you know, the hero story? You get to marry the princess and not pay taxes. That's a hilarious detail. I don't know, did anyone find that funny? Right, the big reward is marry the princess and don't pay taxes. Hooray! And David's concern is, this guy is insulting the living God. And that needs to stop. And in this story is so easy to tell as an action one because this plucky young hero goes and decides, you know, with his own courage to face the giant on his own. But it's really a story about David trusting God to not play the same game. To not go hero versus hero. It's easy to read this story and go to what are the Goliaths you face in your life? What are the big challenges? And make it a story about our pluck and our courage, us becoming heroes. But I believe this story is meant to teach us not to play this game. And unfortunately, as we read further in 1 Samuel, it is going to be a story, a lesson that David forgets as an older man. Because this isn't a fairy tale, this is a history. And it's about human beings and the messiness of life. God over and over throughout scripture, throughout history, teaches his people, you can trust me with your lives. You can trust me in the face of difficulty. And has anyone here ever learned a lesson and then forgotten it the next day? Anyone want to claim that they've never done that? But the lesson still stands, and God will keep teaching me. The Lord saves, but not with the sword and spear. The Lord saves, but not in the way that we, with our worship of heroes and actions and the great might, not in the way we expect or even want. What we want when we're facing our Goliath is a better Goliath. And that's who we want David to become. We want David to be the Goliath with the sling, the Goliath with the cunning. But David doesn't say, Goliath, I'm coming at you with a stick. That's what Goliath's offended about. David says, I come at you in the name of the Lord. We do face tremendous challenges in life. And hey, let's stick with the metaphor. We face our giants, we face our Goliaths. But God doesn't want us to face them by matching the evil that's facing us with our own. God doesn't call us to meet aggression with aggression, or grief with anger, or fire with fire. calls us to trust that he has a different way. You know that I volunteer with the homeless a fair bit and get to know people in very difficult situations. It is ridiculous how well it works when someone is getting aggressive and angry to just speak with calmness and offer a cup of coffee. Right? I've had someone screaming in my face and said, okay, this is a really bad situation. You want to sit down and talk? And it doesn't by any means always work. There's no magic solution. But you know what usually puts out a fire? Is some water. And I've seen social fires pulled out by, do you want a glass of milk? And this story is by no means the most important example of this in Scripture. How do you fight fire? How do you deal with the fact that the world is full of evil? Well, here is God's answer to that question. You kneel in a garden and pray with desperation. You come as the Messiah, the chosen one, not with a sword and spear, but with words of kindness and gentleness, with a challenge to the authorities that doesn't come from having more might in an earthly way, but trusting in the Lord. There's a moment in the Good Friday story, in the crucifixion story, when Jesus is being arrested and his disciple Peter whips out a sword and cuts off the ear of one of the guards. Peter is acting the hero. And you know what Jesus says to him? Put it away. If you live by the sword, you'll die by the sword. And then he says, don't you think that if I asked my Father to send 12 legions of angels, if God wanted to fight that way, don't you think God could? Put it away. And the hero, Peter, with the sword, doesn't stop Jesus from being arrested. He doesn't stop Jesus from being tried. He doesn't stop Jesus from being nailed to a cross and killed and buried. But is that a story of God failing? No, the Lord will save his people, but not with the spear and the sword, not with triumph and violence, but with mercy and grace. It's easy when we feel weak to just want to be strong. But we're not called to that. We're called to let God be strong for us and with us. We're called to let God be strong through us, even in our weakness. We're called to let God win. And God, the God who's actually the strongest, chooses not to fight fire with fire, but chooses to fight our sin with the strongest weapon that there is, which is forgiveness. God doesn't need you or me to be a hero in this world, where armies still face off against each other, both literally and in our own lives. God calls us to trust and live in his grace. Amen. We now have a chance to respond to God's generosity and kindness towards us with our offering. Let's stand and sing a blessing. In this world, it is easy to use our resources as weapons or armor to protect us against the challenges of life. Thank you for the chance to give freely and with joy. And we ask that we will use what we offer now, use what you have given as your church to spread your love with gentleness and kindness to a city that needs your love. In Jesus' name, amen. And our next hymn is number 643, Lift High the Cross, and we'll sing verses 1, 4, and 5. And Lord, with with more difficulty, we thank you for our weaknesses. We thank you for the ways you've made us that we, in an earthly sense, wish were different. Thank you for the ways we need each other and the constant way in which we need you. Lord, we pray that you will use our gifts, our strengths, and our weaknesses to bless this city around us. We have people that we love that are in distress, facing death and illness, facing grief and loneliness, facing confusion and fear. God, you know them. You love them even more than we do. We ask for your help and for your wisdom to be upon us, to know how to help through you. God, we pray for our city, for the increased anxiety and anger that's around us in Sarnia. We pray for kindness and compassion for those who are without a home and trapped in addictions. We pray for those who feel lost and in despair. God, will you bless this city and give us wisdom and courage. Lord, we pray for our world, especially places facing the horrors of war and those making decisions. We pray for leaders to avoid the temptations of power. Lord, we pray for the outcast and the weak, for the refugee, for the hungry, to whom your kingdom truly belongs. We ask that you will send us in the power of your Holy Spirit to be an answer to prayer, to be the blessing to others that you are to us. And we pray this all in the name of your greatest gift to us, Christ our Lord and Savior. Amen. And we end with a prayer that God will be with us. Number 794, Abide with me. Let's stand and sing together.
Thank you.
now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, today and forever. Amen.